and good evening, and welcome to episode 6 of Doddie Aid. You've got myself, Martin, or Minnie, and making this a menage a trois this evening. Ooh. We also have Ali Skywalker McLeod, and we also have Johnny Red, John Gemmell.
Scotland!
Straight out the bat.
Just in case, for the avoidance of doubt, this is to do with a rugby match that was on. Don't know if anyone's seen it yesterday, so this is Sunday. So yeah, it was on yesterday. And Scotland done the usual and just beat England. So
That's the usual now.
That's pretty exciting. Pretty exciting. So a few sore heads today.
I woke up about 3 a.m. and it felt like I had the most aggressive heartbeat in my ears. Just like throbbing a circle around. Oh, it's horrible.
Lovely. What did you get up to for the game, Ali?
Very quiet. Rory had his. He was invited to his first birthday party. So yeah, when you have kids, it's your rugby and drinking time is curbed to a minimum. But anyway, I was meant to take Skylar with me to round to a friend's house, and then eventually that got curbed and said, you know, you can have the night off. He said, if you can wait till 5 o'clock. My wife was like, Lorna said, like, I'll take Skylar. So I was like, okay, I can live with that. So yes, I had about 4 beers, and then when the game ended, the guys I was watching this, they're more football guys, so they just watched the game and then they all fucked off home. So I was stuck in this guy's house in the middle of Newton Mounds, and I'm like, fuck, I better get a taxi then, shall I? So yeah, it wasn't exactly cray cray.
Cray cray.
What you get for watching football fans?
Yeah, I know. So, yeah. They're like, they scored, and they're like, is that good? You know, how long is left? I'm like, oh my God.
Why is that guy in the white trying to play volleyball?
Oh, well, that's it. So they were like, is that bad? So what do you think will happen there?
I was like, where's the baskets at?
Oh, so,
yeah, very, very good performance.
Where did you go to watch it, Minnie?
I ended up, it was... We had Amanda's cousin's 40th, happy 40th, Sean. And beforehand, it was another guy that I used to work with, my good friend Chris. It was his wee girl's head wedding, so I nipped into Sportsters in Glasgow Street. So I literally got there just before kickoff, seen him, watched the game with a few people I used to work with, and then headed over to Southside for Sean's thing. So it was very pleasant. But there was the only problem I had was there was a guy behind us that the whole time kept cheering England, which really was winding me right the fuck up. But the thing is, I heard him talking, and he wasn't actually an English fan. He just said, I just like winding people up. So I was you can keep doing that, but you're going to end up with a glass in your face. But not by me, I'd never do anything like that. I don't condone violence. But there's a few tasteful characters there that might have had more than
you were just speculating there might be a Begbie-esque person.
I was needling. I was like, can you believe he's shouting that? Just another shot.
Stir that pot.
If only you had a glass. Oh, is that a bottle you've got there? Just standing behind him, I'm like, yeah.
And just in case you need a wee tip, underarm means no malice, so you can't even get done for it.
It's just like an uppercut with a bottle.
Jesus. Right, anyway.
Look at this YouTube video that I found.
Yeah, very, very good. Very happy. And Gemma, you obviously had the pleasure of being in the ambience of attending. Like a phenomenal mate,
honestly, see when England went 17-10 up, it went a bit flat. I think people were like, because we'd hardly had any of the ball. We've been, like, the defence was unbelievable. But I think they went 17-10 up and everyone was like, oh, it's going to be this again, isn't it? We're going to get it done. And see when they got that penalty try. Like, after that last, was it 10, 15 minutes, the noise in the stadium was incredible. Like, the atmosphere just ramped back up, and everyone was like, hold on, we're going to do this. We're actually going to do this now. But yeah, I mean, England should have won it, I thought. They had so much of the ball, but they just seemed to want to kick it.
Just what you do with the ball, though, isn't it? You know?
Exactly. Finn Russell with 2 crossfield kicks, one after another. That is just outrageous, man.
What great vision, though, as well, seeing the mismatch out there. Because, what was it? Was it a prop or the hooker? I think it was. He just literally shat himself. He just was like that. Nope.
He caught that.
But, yeah, thank God he didn't.
Tough cheese, as they say down in South
Bay. I thought we... Hard cheese or whatever. That we turned over from Darcy Graham right at the end.
Yeah. That was unbelievable. Burrowing in like a little squirrel.
Feel bad. I was always like, I just don't know if I think he's that good. And then he tore up. And I've been saying for months, he's the future.
But the try, it's a bit him cutting through as well. Like he had a great game.
The step past Marchant.
Yeah. Oh, he had some gas on him as well.
But what about that? The debut scrum half that when the squad was announced like a month ago, everyone's like, who he? Comes on, HIA replacement. Tears in for a try, and then it must have been like when there's like Ali Price is coming back on, he must have been like, what else do I have to do to stay on this pitch?
Are you not entertained? No, it was pretty good. On the theme of rugby, we've got a bit of royalty on tonight, guys. We have former British Lion and Scotland captain Rob Wainwright. More importantly, driving force, the productivity hurricane that is Rob Wainwright for Doddie. He's going to join it. He's going to turn this menage a trois into a foursome.
There we go.
So, quite interesting to see what he's got to say.
I like productivity hurricane. I like that phrase.
Working on that all week.
I was say, I can tell what line of work you're in just firing all these buzzwords out.
Podcast.
Classic podcast buzzwords.
Hey, podcast, mate.
Podcast toilet roll. That's it sitting there. What's my word of the day for the podcast?
It was actually a phrase, not a word. Thank you.
Wow. Okay.
You're welcome. we're here to have fun, but we can educate. So what do you reckon? Should we get him on? See if he's ready to tornado his way in?
Good idea.
Let's do it then.
Get him on.
Let's do it.
While I try to think of another powerful bit of wind.
Tsunami.
Right, let's get him on. So, welcome to the back bar. We have the first captain of Scotland in the pro era, ex-British Lion, ex-army doctor, and now proud farmer, Mr. Rob Wainwright. How are we doing? Welcome to the back bar.
Like you, it being, I think we can say this being the evening after Calcutta Cup night, we're all slightly below par. But we're smiling, we're happy, and every so often, if I don't remember how the night went, I can sniff it on my buff.
That'll be the good.
It didn't all make the mouth. It didn't make the mouth, did it? Yeah.
This is the best thing about this.
Slightly peated.
There's so many functions for these snoods. You can pull your hair back, you can work out what happened the night before. Absolutely brilliant. But yeah,
piece together our journey from last night.
I suppose first place to start, Rob, thoughts on the game? All right.
It's a lot more fun talking about these things after we win, because you know, in terms of the roller coaster ride that was yesterday's game, it was much the same as the roller coaster ride on many of these games. But at the end of it all, the cards fell to us, and we were arguing about the penalty try or arguing about whether a penalty should have been given at the end, various things. Everyone said, yeah, but it's our time, and the ability of this team to win ugly, and it wasn't even that ugly, but to be 7 points down with 15 minutes to go, and then turn it round with, and actually when you think how little possession we had, it was a remarkable result. Defense was fantastic, our discipline was very good, and then there were just two little bits of, speeding up, changing the focus with Darcy Graham's amazing break all came off, speeding the things up very quick. You know, it was out of the line out, I think, before we even knew it. And then later on with the two cross hits, one in one direction and the other in the other direction to get the penalty try, was just beautiful bits of unpredictability. But in terms of a Six Nations game, it was the ultimate Six Nations game, and it was tidal. You know, it was all England possession in the first half, but they couldn't break through, and you felt Scotland, you know, then they got the try and then they were up to 10 points, and it all felt like Scotland. Then after half time, the tide turned again and it all ebbed, ebbed England's way, and then Scotland came back, and then England looked like they might get it, and then right at the end, it could have gone either way. Mm-hmm. And I remember looking at the watch, 78 minutes and 2 seconds, and I think that was the moment the Scottish crowd finally decided they could start celebrating that the Calcutta Cup would be staying in Scotland. Even if it was a draw, they would be staying in Scotland. But yeah. I know you were there, John, weren't you? The in the second half was reminiscent of the great days of 2000 and 2006, 2008. But 2000 is the particularly memorable one where I was behaving in a very unprofessional manner in the press box. In among a lot of ex-England players who were all writing for newspapers as well, and it was fantastic. But I had the honour of watching it next to Mike Tyndall yesterday, and I had a running commentary from him, and he knows his stuff. And so I've been down in Twickenham, you know, on awful days, and with pals who played for England, and so I was kind to him. So I've been that little ball of misery in among, you know, 10,000 people in that area of the stand celebrating as England romped home, you know, against very little opposition. But so I didn't celebrate too much at the end, just a quiet.
As long as there was the wee condescending pat in the back, being like,
and there'll always be next year. Hey, you know,
you'll have your day sometime.
Well, I felt when I squeezed his shoulder, it was more solidarity, but he maybe read it as nothing irritates me more than I remember Joost van der Hesse's and doing it in the third Lions test when they've scored a try. The person who missed the tackle, he leant down and ruffled the hair off. Oh. You know, and that for me is like, that is the ultimate no go.
That's classic number nine behaviour, though, isn't it? They're all just wind up merchants. Yeah.
Well, I grew up in South Africa, and Joost was one of my heroes growing up. I used to love him. Him and James Small.
He's another angry one, wasn't he?
Yeah, he was.
You went for the settled character.
Yeah, that says a lot about my personality.
Yeah, exactly.
But I remember it was the World Cup, and James Small was tackled Jonah Lomo, and he was like probably the first person to actually take him down as a one-man tackle. And we were in a golf club watching it, and just everybody's eyes were on the TV, and the place erupted when he tackled it. You've seen smaller cheers for a try, but small tackling Jonah Lomo got the biggest cheer of the night.
It probably was the first time anyone single-handed. The one I remember from that game was Yappy Mulder barging him into touch when he was romping down the left wing there, and it looked like any other game he would have walked in. Yappy Mulder, he wasn't a big guy, but my God, he was
solid
for those days. Barreled him out. So
the rendition of Flower of Scotland in the stadium on the full-time whistle yesterday.
Yeah.
It was just like, normally, like, Scotland win a game, everyone's like, yay, and then just starts walking down the stairs.
Yeah.
Nobody was moving. Everyone was just lapping it up. And I'm in the kind of, is it the south or northwest corner? I can't remember. I'm in West 6. So kind of upper tier.
Where they walked to after they got the cup for the second time, after Hoggy had gone and presented himself with the cup, and then put it back, and the princess presented it. So
he just got too excited and took it as mine.
Yeah, but then they walked down to the southwest corner, where I would say most of the singing was coming from. Mm-hmm. It almost seemed like there was one Flower of Scotland coming from the northeast and another one coming from the southwest.
But we had quite a lot of England fans dotted in amongst us, so it was really good banter through the game. Because they obviously, when they got to 17-10 up, started to get a wee bit cocky.
Yeah.
Another heads came up again once 2017. Beautiful.
Well, in the cafe in the Isle of Col, there was a Doddie Cup 500 for the team. I was at the Col cycle team who were doing it. Did a fundraiser and raised an amazing £800 from our little island. But there's a few people from south of the border that live in the Hebrides. One of them was getting rather cocky with about 15 minutes to go. That would be And and my son reminded him that you shouldn't get too cocky because they were 31-0 up once. And sure enough.
I like it.
Skur, as he's called, was very quiet come the final whistle. Everyone else wasn't. So.
I can imagine.
Yeah. I was actually at, see that game you were talking about, Rob, down in England, the 38-all game. I was at it and I was so drunk that I didn't even know it was a draw until the next day. Because
really?
At half time, I was like, oh, this is terrible. And I just destroyed the bar. And it was only the next morning when I was watching the highlights. I was like, oh, we got a draw there. That's amazing. But so good.
You didn't notice in the second half. Or have you got no memory of the second half?
No, I was just sitting on screensaver mode. I was just sitting.
All right. Oh, you missed one of the, one of my great regrets. We cycled down. That was the first time we did the ride. And we were zombies when we got there. And we went into a bar just now by the railway station and had shares and stuff. And then, some people went, Ian went and watched it with his father and said it was, you know, the second half was probably the best 50 minutes of his life, because the spirit, you know, the silent Scots, of which you were one in the first half, turned into, you know, it was just unbelievable. And we were considering going to our accommodation at half time. And I remember I went off to the loo, and on the way I just stopped enough to see McAnally do the interception and or the charge down and score that, and it was just enough to give us hope. And and we said, should we go? And we went, well, let's just see what happens.
Five more minutes.
And about 10 minutes in the second half, there was a single ticket for the match sitting on the table in the middle. We were watching on the big screen and we were all around the table, and in the middle there was a single ticket that no one had used, and we were all looking at it, you know. How long would it take us to get there and get in and find us? And would it be worth it? Would we miss it all? And no one took it in the end. But I've always kind of regretted that I didn't get there for the last 20 minutes when, you know, it was a home match for Scotland. Yeah. Apparently, you wouldn't know about that, though, would you?
Well, look, no, the thing is, in retrospect,
a sad slumped corner.
The thing is, I did watch it back so that if people do talk about it, I know what they're talking about. Yes. And I physically was there, so if I put those together, I've got these.
I reckon you'll have been getting quite rowdy as Scotland clawed back and then got into the lead, but you've just got zero memory of it.
Yeah, just shouting noise.
Yeah, I had a kilt on as well, so yeah. I probably was getting quite
rude. Were you upside down? Were you upside down by the end? Had you been propped upside down and everyone was just pouring drink, you know?
You know, like, it wouldn't be the,
were you
wouldn't
that
be the first
guy?
Time.
Were you that guy?
It wouldn't be the first time, and I don't think it'll be the last. I'm down at Cardiff next weekend, so we'll see how that pans out. I'll try and remember that one.
Excellent. I'll look out for an upside down Scotsman.
Or just check the disabled toilets. He normally goes for a sleep in the disabled.
Favorite napping spot.
He's looking forward to next week, and and I think we should stop next week as far as we go, because next week we've got Ireland France, which is, you know, we've got three unbeaten teams after one match, you know, three winners, and there'll certainly only be two by next week, and obviously we've got to do our bit. We've got to capitalize on the Welsh being in a bit of disarray, but Wales at home, stung by yesterday's result against, albeit an Ireland team that beat the All Blacks not that long ago, didn't they? And we've kind of, you know, we should never underestimate the moment there. Rugby over there is so strong. So, but Ireland have got a win in France, which is going to be a humdinger of a game. Looking forward to watching that. Is that? That's after. That's the second game on next week, isn't it?
Yeah, because we're the quarter past two kickoff. Then it's that's that one. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, I'm excited for it already.
Yeah, I know. I'll probably sleep through it. I will. Not for the same reason as your area of expertise.
sleep, you know.
Yeah.
Right then.
All right. Well, what we'll do is we'll maybe crack on with some questions. We'll put you through the mill with a few questions. So one of the first
multiple ones, choice, is it?
that's only my bag, to be honest. Yeah, right. So we'll jump on to Doddie Aid, which we've all been kind of involved with. Obviously yourself, probably one of the main figureheads with Doddie Aid. So what does Doddie Aid really mean to you? With everything that you're doing with it,
it means don't see my family much from mid December, maybe late November. I'm the saddest one in the corner. Yeah, tapping away. So, are we ready to go out? Yeah. I've just got a couple more things to sort out. So, it's been amazing. It's you know, when it's been brilliant, it's been brilliant. When it's been a lot of work, it's been a lot of work. But you know, it's nothing compared with what my pal Doddie's going through. And you know, there's such a great community with Doddie Aid. It's extremely gratifying. You know, we've got 17,000 people involved this year. Slight disappointment that we couldn't get the numbers up to lockdown numbers, but you know, that's possibly to be expected. But you always aim high and hope and push. And we haven't quite reached the heights, but I'm still not writing off 1 million as a target. We've got a fair bit to go. We've got about 300. The hope is that we can make that up with the big cycle down to Wales. We've got 110 cyclists and about 60 support crew going down in various teams from Murrayfield to Cardiff. In 48 hours. Most of them are doing it in relay. A number will be trying to do the whole thing, 500 miles in 48 hours, which means I won't be much use when it comes to the France Ireland game.
Yeah, and definitely been having a wee power nap by then.
Yeah, I think I might need more than the power nap, or I just a lot of thing is I will have used all the coffee. You know, I don't. There's only so much coffee you can drink, and
yeah.
The last time I did it, which was going down to that game, the Twickenham 38-all one. We've done it once since then. I discovered the joys of slow-release caffeine. The guarana berry is another source of caffeine. Things that you don't know about if you do stupid things like this. And the guarana berry is now my friend. And instead of getting that caffeine rush that you get from a double espresso, you get slow release energy, and it's look out for your guarana berry.
So what time are you due into Cardiff then? Do you get in just before the game, or is it the night before, or what?
No, we leave at 10 a.m. on Thursday and get down there at 10 a.m. we hope, if we manage the challenge, which is due in 48 hours, 520 miles, and quite a lot of climbing. We spend a lot of time going backwards and forwards across Wales, and it's not a flat country, sadly. But we had to, the route is kind of set by who we knew where. So the kind of organizing committee is Mike Griffiths, who's in charge. He's the event chief. He's in charge of the support. Mark Bowman, the endurance cyclist, he's been one of the main players there. And the guy who kind of started it is a boy, Russ Kessley, who cycled up from Twickenham to Murrayfield four years ago and did it the first time, literally just after, not that long after the foundation had been set up. Right. He did a fundraiser. And I can't remember how I came to be in contact with him, but somehow or other, a year later, I think I decided this would be a good idea, let's do it as a fundraiser. And then Russ got in touch, and anyway, Russ is the nutter. He is a total nutter when it, you know, me, I take a bit of guarana and I do this every so often. This is his life. So he felt the 500 in 2 days was too easy. So at the moment, he is cycling up from Twickenham to Murrayfield on his own into some pretty unpleasant
headwinds.
So he loves this stuff, he relishes it. So I think he's in York at the moment. Says he's somewhere in York, and so he just felt 1,000 would be, you know, a bit more in order than just 500. So.
Can you sign up to Team Glasgow? Because we could really do with the miles, to be honest.
I think I've persuaded him to be North and Midlands, because Middlesex is North and Midlands, isn't it?
Right, okay.
Going to Doogie by Pond, everywhere is North and Midlands, because your heart's on the island. So, we've got a couple of, if you think he's bad, we've got a guy who's done 5,000 miles on Zwift in January.
I saw that guy the other day. I can't remember the name, but I saw it and I was like, geez. How
Ross Duncan, Duncan. How do you fit a job in? A job in and Friday night, Saturday night at the pub? You know, I think he's had to sacrifice a few of the regular commitments that most of us take for granted.
See, 5,000 miles, I could give up my job for 2 months and I'm still not able to do that.
I think he sacrificed his arsehole because it's going to be broken. Oh, you know? 5,000 miles sitting on a bike, you know, absolutely.
I'm happy to say I have no knowledge
of the condition of his
sacrifice in these departments. Yeah.
Give me his number. I want to text him. I want to find out.
I'll put you in touch. You can take your magnifying glass down.
I didn't say full inspection. I just said
that is the creepiest message. By the way, you don't know me. Yeah. I just want to ask, how's your arsehole?
Can I pop over and have a look at it? It's not how it sounds.
It's all above board.
Anyway, maybe you had other thoughts on that, but that was the first thing that came to my mind.
Talking of the Doddie Cup 500, then, like, what sort of, because that is just an insane, like, 500 miles, 48 hours. What sort of training have you been doing for it then?
Much the same as Ross Duncan, but not quite as much. I've done 5 miles outside on the bike in the last couple of months, I think. Partly because the weather has been unremittingly awful over in the Hebrides for the last wee while. But I'm now on the mainland and I'll probably go and do some road. And I've got to remember how to keep the bike upright, because it hasn't got the stabilizers anymore, so it's gonna be hard. But yeah, just miles. It's not in terms of. I mean, if you want to go into the sports science bit, my theory is that if your threshold, your anaerobic threshold, is as high as possible, then it means your zones of, you know, just being, you know, there's various zones, heart rate zones. Mm-hmm. The lower zone you're in, the more you can do it. So the higher, so I just work to get my threshold as high as possible. And then you just got to get some miles in as well onto your leg. Yeah, your bike set up right, have the right gear, look after your undercarriage alley, look after it, don't need any infections. Apply plenty of chamois cream.
I was going to say slapping on the chamois cream.
That is pretty much the most important thing. And you would not believe how many people will not be doing it at every stop. And there will be some unbelievable craters for Ali to inspect.
I'm just going to Google that, because I've been killing myself on this Peloton bike. So what's that called? Yeah. Chamois cream.
Chamois cream.
Chamois cream. I'll say to the wife, what's on the shopping list? Do we need any fruit? Do we need anything? I was like, no, I need some of that.
Is this like some kind of like cream for your
for your gooch?
For the downstairs bit.
Yeah. Stops the chafing.
That's it must be a better Scottish way to describe it, mustn't it?
Maybe that's a seller for Doddie Aid, maybe fundraiser. Doddie Aid Gooch Rub.
I'll sell
that ahead of next year's Doddie Aid
undercarriage putty.
So just put a Doddie Aid badge on it and that's it sold, you know.
There we go. Lots of people do it. Lots of people have their own brand of chamois cream, as it's called. There's a golden rule of chamois cream, and it's all about double dipping. Because of what happens, if it's in a tube, it's fine. So you can't double dip in a tube, but often it's in a tub. And people will go, you know, they'll come to the RV, the support vehicle, and they go, oh, I need some chamois cream. Where's mine? Can't find it. Oh, here's John's stuff.
Oh, great. No. So,
take a dip. Bye. And then you go, not enough. And you come back with a finger. And that is the no-no. Double dip. It's one of the greatest crimes in cycling. You never double dip in someone else's chamois.
This is why I don't snake, oh man. This is
an etiquette.
Oh yeah. My god. You see, when you first said that, I thought it was like,
do you think someone was actually sitting into the tub?
Yes.
I thought you were sitting in a tub like this size.
It's just. Remember the old gel bottles when hair gel was the thing? It just looks like hair gel, but it's but it ain't gel.
All the things that we were going to talk tonight, I didn't think that was going to be one of them. But
it is endurance cycling, or anyone who cycles a lot. This is a very important topic.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
We're looking at
something new every day.
Exactly. We're a health podcast.
And believe me, if you get it wrong,
it's a bad
damage. Is let's not even talk about it.
Yeah. Okay.
I think they're the Japanese flag. Japanese flag.
We'll not talk about it, but we'll give you a visual idea.
You're not selling my cycling stuff to me at all here.
I know. That's it.
Japan flags and double dipping, man.
No double dipping.
Right. So we'll move on from this anyway. So,
before we move on, going back to the serious side of it, we're meandering our way, and the route has been decided by where we're new people. So I got a cousin in Birkenhead, so we're going to Birkenhead Rugby Club, and he was thinking of buying a hotel over near Dolgellau. Which is over near, and then Russ had been, I think, at university at Aberystwyth, so they were all decided, and then we had to find someone. We've got a team from Rhythyn in North Wales, and they're our top fundraisers. They've raised, they're on about 28 grand or something like that for their team of four so far, which is unbelievable. And then north of that, there's a team from Selkirk, so we're going Selkirk. We're going to Alpine Bikes at Marchmont in Edinburgh on the way because they sponsored us. So we're going for a wee photo call. Not exactly on the route, we're just bypassing via them. And then Selkirk, my sister lives at the top of the A7 between Hoyt and Langham. So there'll be the Cheviotdale's Women Institute will be giving us tea and cake at the top there. And then Penrith. So we've got Martin Johnson's coming to ride the first 120 to Penrith, which is fantastic to have a man of his caliber coming to support it. And
he's a big guy for a bike.
very popular to sit behind because he's
windblock.
He's going to punch a big hole. Which will give me a rest because that's normally my role is to be the draft horse. and then we're going down to Gloucester. We've got a lot of Scots connections down at Gloucester, so we're going down there, and then across Chepstow, Newport, and at Newport, hoping that quite a lot of people will come out of Cardiff and cycle the last bit with us, and then finishing at Cardiff Castle, which is where I'm seeing who's going down to the game.
Martin.
We'll see you there, Martin.
Yeah, I'll see you there because I'm staying.
10 o'clock.
In fact, you know what? We'll make a date. 10 o'clock. I'll be there with a wee cup of Garang juice, whatever it is.
That just sounds like something Glaswegian.
Is that here or down there?
I'll get this. I'll manage to procure some chamois stuff, and
you need that at the start.
Job will be done. Chamois creams.
Well, that's for your journey back up. Right, the
road. I'm gonna be asleep on the journey back up the road for sure.
Yeah.
So.
Yep, the offer of a coffee is there because I'm staying just beside Cardiff Castle. So if you get in there at 10 o'clock, I'll make sure that we're down to get a wee coffee for you, mate. No bother. And nice.
Where are you staying? Are you in the Hilton then, are you?
Nah, I don't like to bring
you in
yeah.
Airbnb. You are
I'm in the Hilton.
I'm in the Hilton,
yeah. So,
very nice.
That's it. So yeah,
his pals had one of those slide out beds for kids, so that he's not going there.
I'll take it.
I would.
Yeah. Well, I'm an expert in the geography of the sort of quarter of a square kilometre around Cardiff Castle now. So we've pored over it to try and get, you know, the best route in, and then where we can go afterwards. So what room are you in? We'll get a number of people who need to shower in your room if you send them over.
I think it's I think it's gonna be brilliant. I think I'm definitely gonna come down with a coffee. I'll probably be hungover, but I'm gonna come down for a coffee for you. So look out for,
if you want, we can give you a coffee, or we'll give you some Guarana if you want. You want some Guarana? So you don't sleep in the second half of the match. I'll keep you awake for the game.
As long as I throw some double dipping Gananga. No, I'm all for that.
Double dipping. Yeah, it's in capsule form. We just need to bend over and we'll pop it in. So.
Ah, well, it's been a good cause. So.
I could just see you coming up, just pants down, like, oh, no, sorry.
Yeah.
Pants out, Corona.
Yeah. I'm going to need to Google this afterwards and look at myself so that I don't start talking to people down in Cardiff going, have you had any of those Granger?
Jumanji.
Oh my God. Doddie Aid again.
Next question.
I don't know where this is going to go now, you know? The roads are, we thought we were going down a single track road, but we've, anyway, the future of Doddie Aid, where do you see it going? Where do you see the future of Doddie Aid?
I see the future of Doddie Aid. I'm having to find a future for Doddie Aid because that's 2 years we've done it now. Is the way we're organizing at the moment, it's, you know, I was chatting with Jill, who's obviously in charge of the foundation, and I said, I can't do it this way next year. It's just too much. And she said, oh, that's not a problem. We'll find a way. We've got the app now, you know, got to make it work. We've got a community, and we've got to make it happen again. I think what I'm going to do is, if you were obviously involved with the first rowing weekend, I'm going to syndicate out the weekend so that I'm not organizing. So this weekend is the dog walk, Doggie Aid, which is really easy for us. The World in a Day last weekend with Mark Bowman, you know, it's a great event he organizes with his team, and I think that's probably the way we'll do it. If I hand over the organization for all the 6 weekends to different people, and then I'm just available to go into my ever expanding contacts list on my phone and prod people. Hopefully they'll all be like Xander Vegas. And Xander, Hamish, Jamie Ritchie, you know, they've all been fantastic. Hoggy has been amazing. They've all been, but in terms of just, no bother, Xander, would you do this? In fact, I'll do a bit more. I'll do this as well. Great.
Yeah, like what he's done with the jersey. Jersey was awesome.
I sent him a text last night after the game because I was had a few beers, so I thought I'm his best pal now. So I sent him just saying yes with loads of S's, and he just came back just with a picture of a wee emoji of a beer. That's all he replied back. I think he was on for a good night last night anyway, so...
I met some people for brunch today, and they'd met Finn Russell. Maybe I'm getting people into trouble here, but I think there was a party last night, and I think the idea of a bubble was well and truly burst. I think last night. That's my impression. So,
that's not confirmed facts.
England's bubble was burst anyway. Here we go. I actually wandered past about 9 o'clock last night. I wandered past John Inverdale on Princess Street. He had his England England rugby jacket on, he had a right sore puss on him.
He did not. I saw him a couple of hours. I saw him in Murrayfield, and he's a lovely guy. He's but he is now, he's an RA. He said, "I'm a buffy now." I know that means something else in Glasgow, but in England. And in England, that means that he's a blazer. He's a committee man. He's on the RFU. He's given up. He's, whereas having moved over to the Hebrides, where there's a lot of Glasgow influence, I now know a buffy means something slightly different. some parts.
Yeah, to some,
I met his wife, so I'm assuming he's not a buffy.
To some people listening, you just broke a completely different story.
Yeah, that's it. I know.
Oh, really? Inverdale a buffy. And he was outed. So,
of all the places to get outed, it's not a
buffy. I know. Oh.
John's a good guy, and he's a nice guy. And if he probably had, that's the first time I've seen him with his wife up in town, so he probably had an argument with her. wanting to get go and drink more and her wanting him to drink less. That's
a global phenomenon, that.
Okay. I'm going to back out of this conversation.
Yeah, I think so.
I'm not saying
this
anything.
Is dangerous territory. But,
So the future of Doddie Aid then is going to come back in 2023.
It's a frightening. It'd be amazing if we can make it bigger. We're going to have to think of some new ideas, but we've got a formula there that in terms of its very basic existence, it's an exercise challenge. How we thrill it up. It would be nice to make the app. The app was obviously in its first year. Of the foundations app, they commissioned it. So I think there'll be more on that. I think people being able to be in multiple leagues would be good, so that people can interact with more of their friends. I've been bouncing from league to league, just keeping in touch with various different groups, but which you can do easily enough. I think a bit more of a record, possibly some linear movement. The first event like this we did on another app called My Global Challenge, which you traveled down, you set a route around the world wherever you wanted, and then you moved down it, and everyone else who's taking part we were all heading on a challenge to get to Malawi, and it was a great race, and there was teams went way, they were way ahead, and then the individuals behind racing down. So we may try and jazz up the app a bit, and we'll be open to suggestions on that. And we've got 11 months to get that sorted. But I think the model will stay broadly similar, and the challenges, we may change some teams. Obviously, we went from the Exiles to the Barbarians this year to make it more accessible to people from out with Scotland. We will have a think, if another area of the world or Britain wanted to get involved, then possibly, there was talk for this one of adding, a region of England, if it was strong enough. If you think somewhere like Yorkshire is bigger than Scotland, to have somewhere like that taking on one of the districts as such. So potentially the geographical building of it. But if it ain't broke, don't fix it. But we've got to be careful. The thing that was so amazing last year was the initial burst of enthusiasm to get signed up. It was a real high for us to have a new event and then have thousands of people signing up a day over Christmas, into New Year. It'd be amazing to build that. But last year, the fundraising that went on in the second half, so we hit about, half a million with people signing up last year. And then the rest of it was pretty much raised by fundraising. And on the second year, you get fundraising fatigue. You get people that feel embarrassed to go back to the same lot of friends and say, give us again. So it's been a harder challenge from that point of view this year. But the fundraising, the people that really push the fundraising are the real stalwarts. And the event... the stuff they've done and the money they've raised has been amazing. Just, you know, I highlighted Rhythin, you know, they're way down in Wales, but Doddie's reach is universal, isn't it? It's it's right the way through the rugby world. And they, you know, there's them knocking on 30,000 raised.
It's fantastic.
And they've organised all the school. We're stopping at all the schools. You know, every primary school in the district is we're stopping at that's on the route, and they're all, the kids are coming to sing us the two national anthems when we stop at 7:30 in the morning on Friday morning. So it's really uplifting. You know, you know, just experiencing the support that people have for Doddie and for, you know, his quest to get on top of MND and find effective treatments initially, and then hopefully the holy grail would be to knock the thing on the head and find a cure.
I think the character that Doddie is, though, like that just is the whole appeal of it. Like, he's just such a infectious, enthusiastic character that everyone kind of can get behind the appeal because of him.
Sorry,
Rob. Sorry.
No, on you go.
Well, I was going to say, like, you know, you've given some examples of people that have got really behind it, you know, clubs and whatnot. I think that's maybe something that in Scotland we could be better at, is having, you know, all of the clubs getting behind this. It's, you know, it should
be,
you know, you get some support from some clubs, which is awesome, but I don't think maybe enough clubs have really adopted it and really tried to drive it on, which is something we should be all kind of hoping to push on for.
Well, I think the way it's all, you know, it's all comes back to that little contact list on my phone, and then your phone, and then everyone's phone. And it doesn't take many phones to have a contact at every rugby club that's going to push it. And some are, you need the passionate people, and you're involved with the social media coordinators WhatsApp group, which is full of some extraordinary people, more than up in the North and Midlands, Richard over in Edinburgh. Etc. Who do, you know, amazing things, and the amount of work they've put in motivating Edinburgh, Orkney, Shetland, the northeast of Scotland, that has just been staggering. And if we can get that level of engagement and get enablers of that sort, you know, more broadly across Scotland, then yes, we could get more clubs. And the hope was that we get. Again, when it comes to the leagues, a lot of people are in leagues with their friends, and they don't want to be in the club league or the school league. And if we can push those side of things and be a bit more proactive and just be a bit more organized, it's literally that's me organized. Believe me, that is me organized. Normally, it's in there, but they're falling out all the time. So many are retained, and then so I'm a bit, you know, disorganized in that way. But I've got you know, this fantastic team, yourselves, all these people who are pushing the agenda, and the more people that are working to expand it, the easier it's going to be, and the more successful it's going to be. So I think we'll work hard over the next year to you know, get a broader base in the management.
Yeah, that'll be good.
Looks like you just signed up, boys.
Absolutely.
Oh, count us in.
We're all in. Happy. Yeah, definitely. We'll be back for next year.
Yep.
Excellent.
100%. But I guess moving away slightly from the Doddie Aid side of things and onto yourself, Rob, looking back at your playing career, like Martin mentioned, first day captain of Scotland in the pro era, British Lions tourist in 97, and you were balancing that rugby career with being a doctor in the army at the same time. I mean, how did you manage those two things going on at the same time? I mean, I can barely manage one job.
I know. Professionalism was a bit of a shock to the system, and yes, you know, a lot of people wanted it to happen, particularly in sort of Wales and South Africa and New Zealand presumably as well, and it was kind of triggered by the threat of a professional kind of parallel league out with the union set up, being set up. And I can't remember who the guy that was going to put the money in, some Australian guy was going to put it, and it triggered it going professional. And it had to change. It had to change very quickly. But before that, you know, for most of us, rugby was some exercise Tuesday, Thursday night. It was a big escape from often the mundanity of our normal life on a Saturday, and a moment, you know, a moment of glory, a moment of shine in a team setting. And then back on Monday or on Sunday, whenever, to, you know, to your normal employment. And as a result, you know, we enjoyed the rugby, and you know, we've had a lot of banter just now. We really enjoyed the post-match as well. And that's what I've always felt, that alcohol is an extremely powerful tool in team building. It gives you, and the biggest bond you can have as a player in any team sport is to play together in a match. But if that is then cemented with memories off the field as well, it really pulls together, and you go from just being teammates to being great friends that last for life. And you know, here we are, Doddie, myself and many others, you know, cemented great relationships because we didn't just play together, but we clicked off the pitch as well. And we've both got slightly daft sense of humours, and both from the country. So, you know, we've been drawn together. He's from the borders, but I can vaguely understand him. So it's been able to communicate. So, but it was a wonderful thing. Amateur rugby was a really wonderful thing. Top end amateur rugby to get the glory that we got. And when I started, you would not believe how amateur it was. It was staggeringly amateur. And, you know, extra training was, I remember when I was at Edinburgh Accies in the early 90s and before I broke into Scotland, extra training at the end of it, David Sowell and John Allen, the hooker from, you know, sort of South Africa and I believe Scotland as well. They'd run around the pitch at the end of training. They do, you know, 20 press-ups at one corner, 20 sit-ups at the next one, halfway, 20 star jumps, and then they'd literally one lap of the pitch. That was it. That was the extra strength and conditioning, full stop, that we were doing. That was it.
Yeah.
And these were top internationals playing for Scotland. And the Scottish team would often meet up on a Thursday night, and they'd go and do a team building session in town.
And is that what we is that what we call a work event these days?
Yeah, exactly. Boris has made them famous again. But it was staggering, and for me, probably what made, you know, everyone wonders what gave them the edge, and I was injured when I went down to university, and I was desperate to get a blue at Cambridge where I was, because my father had one. I couldn't play rugby because I had a knee injury the first term. So I joined a boxing gym and did boxing. And boxing is completely opposite. Even the most amateur boxing, you are going through hell and back on a daily basis to get to be able to stand in a ring, unbelievably, for 6 minutes. It doesn't sound long. It is the longest 6 minutes in your life. And you, if you're not, you know, completely on top of your game in terms of your fitness, you'll last a round if you're lucky. And just doing that for a couple of seasons just kind of put me on a slightly different trajectory in terms of rugby. Wasn't just about throwing the ball around, a bit of unit skills on a Thursday and then a big drink afterwards, you know, on a Saturday night. There was more preparation involved, and I think that's probably where I got my edge. But when we went to professionalism, we weren't very good at professionalism either. And me, because all the coaches were used to doing was training unit skills. So we do more lineouts, more rucking, more scrums. But no one, you know, sought to give me a better pair of hands. I had issues with my handlings that got worse as I got older. But at no stage did they say, you know what we need to do? We need to, you know, sit you down and let's rebuild your handling technique. Not at all. So you'd work a bit on that on your own time. But It was, you know, it took a long time for the whole thing to evolve, and we are where we are now. And for me to look at the modern player and the skill set that they have, it's just staggering. They are so skilled. So there's a penalty try for Darcy Graham. And I think the key thing there that wouldn't have been in place 30 years ago is that the expectation that Darcy Graham would catch that kick was 95% probably. Mm-hmm. And therefore they could say he would have caught it and scored the try. When I was playing, there was probably, you know, 60% maybe tops expectation that that person would catch that kick, because our skills were so much lower than they are now. And the sadness for me in the modern game is that the defences and the strength and conditioning have also moved forward so far that the weight of the players and the impact that's happening in contact is A, dangerous for the players, but B, has removed a lot of the entertainment from the game, because there's so much, you know, preordained runners to try and tie up, you know, try and soak up some defenders. It's not the spectacle that it possibly was 30 years ago. And it's been a kind of slow demise. And I'm a great advocate for some action from World Rugby to make a difference to that. And the first thing for me, and I know I lived through replacements rather than substitution. And there was a lot of abuse of it. But I think with audit in the modern game, they'd be able to read that out. But I think the substitution has got to go. If someone only has to play 45 minutes of the game, he can carry a lot more weight around than if he has to play 80 minutes. So, that would be the first thing. And, you know, there's various other things. They're tinkering with the rules, but they haven't found the holy grail yet to make the game more dynamic and reduce the physical impact.
No, it's definitely the modern game is, even though it is gladiators, you know, it's entertaining. You see the size of some of them, and again, from just when we were kind of finishing up, you know, I was about 29, 30 when I finished playing rugby. The guys that were 10 years younger than us were twice the size of us, twice as fast. You know, they were coming out of schools, you know, they were hitting weight training at 16. As soon as they were allowed to go into the gym, that was the first thing they were told to do. It was weight training, you know, build your weight up, build everything up. So, you know, these guys are going to become 19, 20. It's 4 or 5 years that they're hitting the gym. Yeah. You know? So, and I think that is so heavily pushed into rugby now, is that you have to be bigger. Yeah. You have to be stronger.
To feel like I saw some of the Scotland England 20s game on Friday night. Yeah. And those guys are obviously 19, 20 basically, and they are proper athletes.
If you
took that back to, I remember going to see a few of the kind of under 21s games when I was a kid, like my dad would sometimes take me to them, and like if you think of the players you saw playing then, or even the guys when we were that age that were in the Scotland teams, and compare to them the guys now, it's night and day.
That's it. You're going to lose. We're never going to have another generation where an Andy Good is a superstar at 10. Not going to see that anymore. Everyone's going to be...
Well, it was interesting. In the under-20s game, I watched the second half of it, and, you know, England has such a massive pool of talent. Scots did really well. But ultimately, they got undone by speed and pace and going for gaps. And I can't remember what the fullback was called, Arundel or something like that. He much single-handedly turned the game, running a couple of amazing tries in from his own 5-yard line. And it was raw pace and sleight of hand and movement that did it, and which is really uplifting, because I think what we all want to see is more of that. We want to see more Shane Williams, Darcy Grahams, rather than, you know, when we think now that we've got Duane van der Merwe, and his ilk, you know, he's not a unique person, but these are all as big as Jonah Lomu was, and Jonah Lomu was considered an exceptional talent. And now that sort of size in the backs is no longer unusual. And look at Stewart, what an amazing specimen he is. Fantastic size, and which made it all the more pleasurable when he knocked that ball on, easy one. And And don't you love home advantage when the whole crowd gets on his back, huge cheer, it's sport, and that's where you've got to make home advantage count and put pressure on the ref. The ref wasn't giving penalties at the end of the game. He wanted to have a nice evening in Edinburgh. He didn't want to have every Scot he met banging on his ear. So home advantage is so important. And we aside there, but I love it when it's used well. And it's used well at all the other, it's going to be a lot harder for us to win away with crowds there than
last year
when we could only win away, So bring it on. Looking forward to it.
No, yeah, good.
Indeed.
Well, listen, what we'll do, we're just going to move on to our last section, Rob. So it's just three quick-fire questions for you, right? So just first thing that comes to mind. So we'll get into these before we wrap up. So we've all nominated one question. I won't tell you who's picked what, but we'll just go with it.
I'll guess.
So the first question we've got is, if you had a superpower, what would it be?
To catch the ball. Those that played with me will know all about that. So that would have been a superpower for me.
Okay, good. Right, superpower, catch the ball. Next up, we've got, who would play you in a movie of your life?
A big Tom Cruise. Should we go for big Tom Cruise? or should we go for Stephen Merchant? Stephen Merchant. Stephen Merchant.
They're very similar. I can see why I mean,
realistically, I wasn't going to get away with Tom Cruise.
Tom Cruise played Jack Reacher, who's pretty tall, so you know.
Yeah.
Can't be done.
He's my height. Yeah, I know, but that's Hollywood. And we don't need to join in their silliness, do we? Mel Gibson played William Wallace, didn't he?
Yeah. And was it Matt Damon played the South African rugby captain?
Francois Pina.
That's the biggest insult to Scottish rugby.
South African rugby.
We took insult to it as well.
It was that ridiculous. Scottish rugby was like,
Who's that? Sorry, South
Africa. When you know something a lot about something and Hollywood doesn't know a lot about it and they have an incidental. So Invictus was, the Nelson Mandela side was extremely well done. Morgan Freeman, an amazing actor. So is Matt Damon. But watching them try to pretend to be rugby players is like, I'm a fisherman. And whenever there's a fishing scene in a film and some farmed rainbow trout gets reeled in and they go, oh, look, I've caught a salmon. And you're thinking, I hate it when you know more than Hollywood does about yourself.
That's true.
Hard work. Yeah. Right. Well, listen, Rob, last question. So if you could pick one current active player for another nation that could wear the jersey for Scotland, who would you want?
It'd have to be what's his name? The French scrum half, he's just exceptional, isn't he?
Yeah,
Dupont. Is it Antoine Dupont? Is it?
He is
a standout player in world rugby. And you see a try today, he's just got the most amazing support runs, hasn't he? Always there, isn't he?
Yeah,
I liked how, we were trying to describe who it was, and Gemmell and yourself, Rob, came out with Dupont, and I went with the more Glasgow Dupont.
Dupont?
Absolutely butchered his name there.
We Tony Dupont.
Tony Dupont, you know. Your brother used to work in the co-op. My uncle went to school with his sister. Tony Dupont.
Aye.
Done well for a wee lad, didn't he?
That's it. Cold places.
Right. Well, listen. That's the speed round done, Rob. That's the speed round done. Just before we finish up, the last question we've got. We've got a back bar playlist in Spotify, so all of our guests put a song on. So it's either something that a go-to for working out or something you like to unwind to, dance to. So what would be your pick? What's your go-to song? Oh,
I spend a lot of time thinking about this. I listen to a lot of music when I'm cycling, and I love inspirational tempo tunes. And I've had long arguments with Jim Hamilton when he's offered tunes that I said, well, how am I going to, you know, be inspired to exercise to that? But every generation has its choice of music. And which of the many ones I love, I, you know, there's fantastic songs. So if I was to go for one, I'm going to go for Another Planet by The Only Ones, which most people will never have heard of, but it's got the most amazing guitar riff in it.
Okay. That's,
we'll get that added.
That's it. Yeah, more exposure to the world now. Everyone will know. It's Rob Wainwright's shout.
That's good. I think it was the only song they did that really made it. But if everyone has one song in them, they had an amazing tune. So
that was by the Only Ones.
Am I lied? Sorry?
Was it by the
Only Ones? The Only Ones. Another Girl, Another Planet. I think it's either called Another Girl, Another Planet, or just Another Planet. Okay. But there's so many I'd like to add, because as one gets older, retrieving information gets hard. But The Bohemian, I'm a Bohemian Like You, by the
Dandy Warhols.
Dandy Warhols, but
I will chuck that on as well.
That's a good part.
That is a really good party song.
Well, that's it. You're only getting two. There's only because it's you, Rob.
We'll give you two. We'll let you slide.
Gets one, we'll give you two.
Because he gave us good advice on the bike, you know.
I know, and I'm away to start researching double dipping.
No double dipping. The biggest crime in cycling, double dipping.
So you don't want to embarrass yourself in front of Chris Hoy.
Jeez.
Chris always changed for me. Chris always is the master of what he calls dad jokes.
Right.
Yeah. Quite bad jokes, really.
Yeah.
But we talk about people who do go beyond where we could ever ask them, you know, for Doddie Aid. And he's been doing his Swift rides. This will be his 12th one on Wednesday coming.
Wow.
They're doing a final one on Saturday morning from 9 till 10 for the end of the Doddie 500. So that'll be 13 he's done. So and that's in coffee and cake money. He asked people to give their coffee and cake money that they would have used on their Sunday morning ride if they were out. And I think he's on about 8,500 he's raised in coffee and cake.
Wow.
Nice. So,
big fan of Chris. We all love Chris anyway.
Absolutely. He's a legend.
In fairness, I won't be donating coffee and cake money because I'm actually buying you a coffee and cake. Coffee and cake money. That's the thing.
Can I book my particular, you know, patisserie? Do I get a choice?
Rob, well, I would not. I wouldn't just buy you. I wouldn't assume. So absolutely. What would you like?
I like the kind of raisin swirl things, but I like the custard ones too. But a fresh pain au chocolat.
How many
am I buying
you,
Rob?
I'll be quite hungry by then.
I'm partial to a cinnamon bun myself, you know.
Is there any
cinnamon swirl?
Yeah,
they are.
We had a girl who was baking on the island this summer, and her cinnamon buns. We had long arguments about whether they were cinnamon swirls or buns. She swore they were buns, but her said, no boys. No.
Okay. So what you're saying is
you made really good bacon.
You want a raisin swirl with a pan of chocolate, with a custard swirl, with a cinnamon bun.
Jeez, that's a sugar bun.
Is there any place? Is it like Costa, or is it going to be Starbucks and all that? Where would you want it from?
I'm going to leave you on quality control. Okay.
Yeah. No pressure.
If you can find an independent patisserie, which is bloody hard to find now, or a baker, a Welsh baker, there must be some. They may say you better take a Welsh cake along, you know.
I was going to say Welsh cake.
Yeah.
I'm just going to take all the pastries from the buffet at the Hilton and just bring them out. Send myself a fortune.
Just wrapping them up in a wee napkin, like what?
The little ones. You can get all the little ones, can't you? They'll have a selection of the little Danish.
Right. And what kind of coffee? If they don't have those berries.
They won't have the berries. The berries come in tablet form anyway. I'll be buried up by then.
So any coffee in particular? You're only getting one coffee. I don't mind buying loads of
coffee. I'll tell you what, a cup of tea would be lovely.
Cup of tea, right, okay. Consider it done.
Milk, nope, sugar.
No sugar. Milk, nope, no sugar. Not too strong.
Make sure it's warm when you get there.
yeah.
A nice Ceylon tea.
What's that?
He's cancelling the trip.
Was that one too many?
I've got my shopping list.
There we go. Excellent.
So yeah, Cardiff Castle, 10 a.m. You better make it in time now. Otherwise, I'm eating it all.
Fingers crossed. We'll be trying our very best. I have to say the weather forecast is looking like it's going to deliver for us, which is fantastic.
And that's excellent.
As we leave Edinburgh, there's lots of big sunshine symbols on Thursday morning, which after what we've had the last few weeks.
Yeah.
And hopefully that means there'll be, if there's a wee bit of north in the wind, that would be the icing on the cake. Blow us then.
Quick question on the route out of Edinburgh to Selkirk, are you guys going down the A7 or what's the route?
No, we're going down to Peebles. We're heading out Hennicutt, Peebles, and then down the Tweed to Selkirk that way, because the Selkirk boys said that was a better route. But
it definitely is better than going down the A7.
Yeah. So, and then onto the A7 from Selkirk onwards, Hoyt.
Okay,
and then Mosspall, and then Uber to the border, A6, then we're on the A6 for a long time until we get down near Liverpool. And that's a whole day takes us to Birkenhead. And then you would have thought you're almost there by then, but we're going right the way across.
I guess if you're Wales zigzagging again,
we are zigzagging big time. We're like a Zorro mark across Wales. And then sleeping at Gloucester on the Friday night. We might, if we keep the schedule, we may get 4 hours sleep there, so we'll be really fresh. Nice. We won't probably need the coffee and stuff like that when we get to Cardiff Castle. We'll double
up on the buns.
Don't worry, there'll be something waiting for you anyway. But yeah, awesome. Looking forward to it.
Martin, you have an amazing night in Cardiff on Friday night. Remember, it's a 2-day gig. Okay, too heavy on night one because Cardiff can be, well, you'll have had a night out in Cardiff.
Before, I've had a couple of nights out in Cardiff. The thing is, Rob, I've now got responsibility on the Saturday morning. So
you've got a deadline. Yeah,
I can't be kicking ass out of it too much. So,
one of us will phone him at 5 to 10 to make sure he's up. Don't worry.
Right, that's it. No, you need to give me time to get coffee for me at 9.
Yeah. Well, if you're looking for him, he's about 5'1", so you can't miss him.
If it's seven and a half, Rob.
All right, so.
Very good. If I don't know who you are, it's probably because I won't know who anyone is by then. Yeah. You'll be
the guy with the massive bag of pastries.
Pastry guy.
When I see the pastries, I'll know. I'll say, it's Martin.
There you go.
That's pastry man.
The whole crew will be up in there. Where's our pastries? you better come with a bag.
Empty. Just literally take a big bag and just sweep in.
Do you know what? I'm not going to pay for that. I'm going to just put them on a bag and be like, this is charity. And just walk out.
Just put Doddie Aid, mate. See you later.
It's as much as you want breakfast buffet. Could you bring us some black pudding and sausage as well?
Oh, Jesus.
Yeah. Sausage, black pudding. Black pudding.
Yeah. I don't know. We'll leave the scrambled eggs. They won't travel well.
Just a couple of handfuls of scrambled eggs.
Some beans.
Bacon rolls and bacon rolls. We will be sick. All the rugby clubs have been, you know, a lot of them are feeding us, and I can guarantee they'll say, well, we've done bacon rolls because we thought that's just what you want. And every club we would go to, they will have said, we've done bacon rolls for you because that's exactly what you'll be wanting. And we'll be going, not bacon rolls again. Anyway,
yeah.
The support we've had, you know, there's 160 something of us turning up at all these clubs, and we just rung them up, and they've all just said, "Yep, we'll do that."
That's awesome. Yeah.
But Birkenhead have got a raise.
Cinnamon buns.
Exactly. Birkenhead have raised $2,500 just, you know, in a whip round at one of their games. I think they've got a check to give us. So, you know, as a final, you know, closing point, when you've got a guy as nice as Doddie and as respected in the rugby world, and he is afflicted by a disease as awful as MND, and his reaction has been so positive to it, and he's decided to take a stance and try and correct the lack of knowledge on it. It opens the whole rugby world up. The rugby world is got its fingers into communities everywhere, all over Britain and the world. So it's amazing what you can do just by using Doddie's name. So at the Hilton, if they question you, just say, "I'm doing it for Doddie," and then they'll say, "Oh, well, why didn't you say? Come on, have some more, have some sausages."
That's it.
I'll do that.
Great. Well, thank you very much for having me on.
Awesome. Thank you, Rob.
It's been an absolute pleasure.
Absolutely.
That was very entertaining. I've learned so much that I never thought I ever needed to know.
He's got just the once, action.
Just one.
Once.
Right, okay. Oh, but yeah, listen, thank you so much for joining us. And you'll get a couple of pages on me on Saturday.
Best of luck with everything, you know.
Yeah, well, thank you so much for all your help over the last 6 weeks. It's Ian's. I don't know how Ian meets all these people. He keeps bringing people in. So, and if I was to put my final word is for my two partners in crime, in the kind of crux of Doddie Aid. I mentioned Mark Bowman. He's been amazing. But in terms of actually running it, all the social media and a lot of the organisations done by Alex GP, he's doing his job. He works for My Name's Doddie Foundation. But Ian Fraser, who you'll know, is just my neighbour's son from Cole. And it's, you know, this whole thing's been forged with between the two of us over the last 4 years. And here we are. And he's just an absolute rock. And he's a silent partner. He doesn't get to do a lot of this front of house stuff. But this is very much his event. We got an award at the Doddie dinner, and I never got a chance the way things panned out when I was up on stage thanking. But so, Ian, big thank you. You've made so much happen, and you've introduced me to these lovely young men here.
First time we've ever been called that as a collective.
I know, exactly.
No, brilliant. Listen, thanks again, Rob. It's been great having you on, and best luck for the cycle. I hope it goes well on you.
Yeah,
it's not too much of a struggle.
Yeah,
We'll see you next year. We'll see some of you next year. We'll see some of you with a bag of pastries at Cardiff
Castle. Yeah, that's it.
Done it. Done.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Thanks, Rob. Nice. Cheers, Rob. Take care. Good luck for the cycle.
Yeah. Bye. Right. Oh my god!
Absolute legend.
Oh, he is a legend. So that is.
Some of the stuff in there, I was absolutely creasing myself.
Wow.
The double dip chat.
We haven't done a podcast like that in a while. We have not done one like that in a while.
That took me by surprise, man.
That's what you get when we get old school on. That's the old school guys know what to do, you know?
Yeah. The old buffies.
Yeah.
John and Bradil the buff there. We Tony DuPont. So pay the scheme to the Stade de France.
You know, man, that was brilliant.
That was great fun.
The main point of that is he's doing another massive effort, massive rollout to get down to Cardiff and again raising money for a really good cause. And it was quite touching just seeing him talking about his pal. You know what I mean? It's not Doddie Weir, it's his mate.
Somebody new and drank with and played rugby with. And it brings it home when it's real. You know?
It's about when he was talking about the rugby. And he was saying like the alcohol and being the team bonder. And it's like the you start the thing with playing with your mates, and then it's you make memories off the pitch. And like as he was saying that, I was thinking, it was like when the three of us and then the other lads that we hang around with, 90% of the stories we talk about are not from on the pitch.
Mm-hmm.
It's nothing to do with that, but that's how it all started, was playing together and then all the fun shit happens.
I do love telling the stories when Raz got emptied a couple of times. That's probably one of my favourite ones.
That's just because it's so rare.
Yeah, that's it. Just, but yeah. So.
I suppose, I think that's the thing though. I think given this is pretty much the last proper Doddie Aid episode, it's,
yeah.
If anyone's still, you know, there's still time, miles in, get raise money, you know, put it on all your social media. Like, it's going to a great cause. So mm-hmm. anything that you could pay, if it's 10 pence, if it's 10 quid, if it's a million quid, doesn't matter, man. Anything that you can spare,
yeah,
you'll feel better for it, guaranteed.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if that's not, buy you a bloody pastry in Cardiff.
Xander Ferguson did a good deed for us, and look what happened to him. You know, his brother, man of the match, winning Calcutta Cup. Good deeds follow good deeds.
I think it's called the Back Bar Podcast Bounce.
I know, that's it.
Come on here, do a good deed, something good happens for you.
Brooke Combe signed up to Amy's record label.
Yeah,
Transmit.
There you go. Mm-hmm.
Well, we're not saying it's because of us, but do you not think it's a bit of a coincidence?
Willie Stewart came on and then won some award for his...
Oh, he did, that's right.
His concussion thing. It happened a while ago, so I can't remember the details, but...
Enzo McCarinelli was on Sky Sports doing the...
He was. I listened to
it last night.
Mm-hmm. Nate Boyer, film just came out. Gianni Capaldi, film just came out.
By the way, this is spooky. So what we're basically saying is Brad Pitt, you won an Oscar, one place to come.
So, which we'll get, we're going to get a request from Owen Farrell next, to be like, he's going to want to come on there. Is that for next year's Six Nations?
I tried to start the Owen Farrell You're Okay yesterday. Nothing. However,
like, it'd be great to get him on, but can you imagine getting him on? He's like, how you doing? He's like, yeah, I'm great, how are you? He's like,
what
champion,
you
did here? Champion. sorry Owen, I didn't mean that.
So, how are you guys? What's going to do with you, Owen?
Don't talk to me in that tone of voice.
I'm here.
I tell you what Chant did take off a little bit when after Luke Cowan-Dickie's volleyball spike.
Huh.
Same old England, always cheating.
Oh, nice. Eddie Jones would have loved that as well.
I know.
Eddie, you okay? Are you okay? Are you okay, Eddie?
That's a good one. I like that one.
He's going to be down the job centre soon, I'd say. You know, picking up his gyro.
Oh, mate, I'll be yeah. Okay.
Yeah, I know.
Was he Welsh, eh?
Yeah, I know that. My voice is all over the place today.
Oh yeah, that's it.
I can barely do my own voice, never mind Eddie Jones.
Anybody want a peanut?
Right. So we gotta get our own miles in as well this week. We've got some miles to clock up.
I know. So. This cold knocked me a mars this week.
We're
to get as much as I wanted to do. But we're over 800.
We're not far off 900 now.
Yeah.
We're, I think, 110 short of 1,000.
Jesus.
We can do it.
Yeah, well, you've got some work to put in this week, bro.
Yeah, I'm slacking so far behind.
Yeah.
I mean, remember, I'm not only here for 4 days, so you guys need to pick up my
plan. Well, it's my birthday on Thursday, so probably not going to do much on Thursday. Then I'll probably be a bit hungover on Friday. It's Ali's wife.
Enzo Macaronelli, they were there.
Oh, you were so close. So close.
How much have you been practicing this week?
it's only about like 60 hours. go to bed, Enzo Macaronelli.
I can't think of a better way to celebrate a big birthday for you as well, 40, by doing a mile for each year.
As Adam would say, away and take a fuck to yourself.
You're gonna need some of that gooch cream for that.
It's my tub, and it's my tub, so I can double dip if I want.
I know. Maybe you just don't go the ride and just put the gooch cream on anyway. Just like, oh yeah, it's my birthday.
Treat yourself.
Okay, sorry. We'll move on.
Anywho.
Anyway, well, yeah, we'll get it smashed, but anyone that's listening, like, just get as many miles in as you can. It's heating up at the top. Obviously, Ali McMillan's joined the league, and he overtook me briefly, but he's going to thump me by the end of it.
I think he sits on a watt bike on level one and just shite bag.
don't, because he's gonna listen to this and then he's gonna message us saying, actually, this is what I do, and record it and send us videos of it and a diary about it. So we're done.
His big sweaty bald head.
We'll get there. We'll get there. But listen, yeah, pleasure as always, gents.
It has been.
We've got a bit of an announcement, guys. So just before we finish off, we've got a big announcement that's coming that Rob's going to help us announce. So eyes and ears peeled. I don't know if you can peel an ear, but whatever. Eyes peeled.
Give me a shot.
For Saturday, there'll be an announcement. And believe me, if you know anything about rugby, you like rugby, you've heard about rugby, someone likes rugby, this is not to be missed.
Oh, or if you like big scary cats.
And the colour red.
I'm not going to add anything again. I'm fine. I'm good.
And Canterbury.
The city of Canterbury.
Yeah, Canterbury Tales. Right, okay.
Anyway.
Awesome. Thanks, lads. See you later. Take care.
See ya. Take a good picture.